Chapter 1421, there is actually such a weirdo in the world. The royal guards swarmed over and examined the woman who was lying there without moving at all. A royal guard quickly came to report, "Your Highness, she has fainted." "Don't be kidding, how many people in this world could withstand His Highness's flying kick?" Even now, this unlucky woman probably could not figure out why she just flew out like this. My lady, you people. Who are you people? How could you treat my lady like this?" The carriage driver scrambled up and lambasted them in a fluster. Yet Crown Prince Mo merely looked at him, his gaze settling on the other party's hands. That carriage driver reflexively looked down at himself. There was nothing other than his chubby hands that were like two white radishes. Mo Lian curled his lips in a sneer. He turned to jump onto a horse that the royal guards had led over and galloped toward North Main Street without looking back. Cough. Cough, cough. When Wai Minglai returned to consciousness, she felt that her chest hurt terribly. That man's flying kick just so happened to hit her chest, giving her the feeling that her chest cavity was going to get crushed in that instant. My heavens, how could there be such an unromantic man in this world? This man's first reaction upon seeing a delicate beauty launching herself into his arms was not to embrace her but to kick her flying. Where did this weirdo come from? Wai Minglai coughed several times. Just as she was struggling to get up with the carriage driver's help, they suddenly saw a swarm of royal guards rush over and press them down to the ground, kneeling with their blades. Wai Minglai's pretty face flushed red in anger, and she abandoned her feigned daintiness upon speaking. "You, what are you people doing? What do you want to do?" However, none of the royal guards paid them any attention. They merely tied the two of them up and flung them on the back of a horse before clamoring as they headed toward the Ministry of Justice's prison. When Wai Minglai saw the words "Ministry of Justice" appear in front of her, she became dumbfounded. She trembled in a bout of anger, her whole body shaking uncontrollably. It wasn't from terror, it really was just anger. That weirdo was actually so resolute in his actions. He not only sent her flying with a kick, but now he was even trying to lock her up in the Ministry of Justice's prison. She could not help but look down and scrutinize herself. Was she not pretty? In this past half a year, both her disposition and her looks had solidly improved by more than one grade. As a result, even the second prince was bewitched by her beauty. But right now, Wai Minglai and that carriage driver were dragged into the Ministry of Justice's dungeon. The jailers cut to the chase and tied both of them to the posts used for interrogating criminals in the dungeon's courtroom. A jailer cracked the whip that had been soaked in peppered water before giving her and the carriage driver a fierce smile. The hairs on Wai Minglai's body stood on end. Crack. The carriage driver screamed like a butchered swine when the whip lashed out. "Tsi, tsi, tsi." The royal guard captain watched on from the side in disdain. "Just from how you're screaming like this from a single lash, how many times do you say you can take?" "Brother, don't hit me. Don't hit me. I'm only a lowly carriage driver." Her ladyship was the one who instigated everything. It was her ladyship. Just as the carriage driver finished his piece, Wai Minglai, who was tied to another post, was so infuriated that she kept kicking him. "What are you cowards saying? You, hit her, hit her. It really has nothing to do with me. This humble one is merely a hired passerby. You wu hash." Chapter 1422, Confession, Hit. At the royal guard captain's order, that whip doused in peppered water lashed the carriage driver's body until he was battered all over, leaving him better dead than alive. Only now was Wai Minglai frightened, and her body shook uncontrollably while tied to the post. She truly was afraid. That day, when she saw His Highness the Crown Prince driving them out of the Marquis of Jiayuan's estate, she should have already known that this crown prince was cold-blooded and merciless. He simply wasn't to be trifled with. But there was no medicine for regret in this world. Before trying, she had thought that she could definitely capture this man's heart with her good looks and bearing. It was only after trying did she know that she and His Second Highness were actually so naive. His Second Highness's mission simply could not be accomplished, because His Highness the Crown Prince was totally heartless, merciless, and frigid to the extreme. He would not show kindness or be moved just because she, Wai Minglai, was a woman, nor would he be like other men and wallow in her beauty, unable to extricate himself. So terrifying. Wai Minglai shuddered, subconsciously gulping down her saliva. By this time, the jailer had already beaten that white and plump man unconscious. He looked very miserable. The whip had sliced up his white robe into strips that were left hanging on his body. There were lash wounds everywhere, on his face, body, and hands. Right now, there was more air coming out of his body than there was going in. "Miss, it's your turn now. Have you decided to confess, or do you want to be like this man?" Getting beaten ruthlessly before confessing, the jailer ogled her well-developed body as he chuckled lasciviously. Why, Minglai felt her body tense, and a never-before nervousness infected her mind. She fixated helplessly on the whip in the jailer's hand, and before he could raise it up high, she screeched out loud, I confess. I'll confess everything." "It's good that you'll confess," the royal guard captain put his hands on his hips. He then took the whip from the jailer's hands and hefted it in his palm. "Speak, who sent you over to screw with His Highness?" Why, Minglai shuddered as she stammered, I'll say it, it's the second prince. I am a sing-song girl from the second prince's estate." The royal guard captain was stunned. But then he sniggered. "Do you know where your greatest flaw was? How could someone who drove carriages year in and year out be so white and plump? Let alone His Highness, who won't believe you. Even me with my level of discernment can notice something fishy with you at a glance." Why, Minglai's face turned ashen. That white fatso was a junior manager in His Second Highness's estate and also the brother of His Second Highness's favored concubine. He usually had His Second Highness's confidence. As this mission of approaching the Eastern Palace was very important, Molu still didn't trust her too much. That's why they had originally planned for this white and plump junior manager to infiltrate the Eastern Palace together with her. He was purported to be her support, but in reality was sent to monitor her, preventing her from forgetting her mission after getting by swimmingly in the Eastern Palace. Yet who would have expected? The Crown Prince was too brilliant and saw through His Second Highness's wishful thinking. Why, Minglai did not know what to think. "You people, what do you want to do?" Why, Minglai's heart was trembling. She did not expect that not only could she not get close to the Crown Prince, but she would even get imprisoned as well. Watching as that royal guard captain had his men loosen her and the white fatso, Why, Minglai shuddered. "Sir officials, this humble girl lies at fault. Stop being fussy, move it." The royal guard captain shoved her along. Chapter 1423, Face Slapping. Why, Minglai staggered forward, her nerves taut. When she looked next to her again, she saw someone taking down that white fatso, whose head had gone limp, and dragging him away ahead of her. "You people, what do you want to do?" Why, Minglai asked while trembling. However, the royal guard captain and the others did not speak to her again. They just dragged both of them onto their horses and urged the horses toward the second prince's estate. Meanwhile, Mola had gone back home all smug, but his joyous mood did not last for even an hour. He saw his steward run in frantically and yelling, "Master, master, there is trouble at the main entrance." The second prince's expression faltered, and he quickly headed to the main door with the steward. He inquired hastily while walking, "What happened?" "Miss Lilai has come back." "Lilai?" The second prince's expression instantly darkened, and his first thought was, Lilai actually failed. She really was a good for nothing. How long had it been, and she just came back? Did she not encounter his good sixth brother at all, or was it that she simply couldn't get close to other people at all? The second prince thought of the pains and effort this past half a year that he put in to cultivate this Wai Minglai, yet at the critical moment, she couldn't make a difference. He strode out the main entrance with a belly full of rage. Yet he was met with a captain dressed in the garb of the royal guard, who saluted him from afar with an artificial smile. "Second Prince, this humble subordinate has sent you a return gift by His Highness the Crown Prince's order. Bring it forward." At the captain's order, 3 to 4 royal guards immediately hauled their captives from the back of their horses and tossed them right in front of the second prince's estate. The second prince looked down and saw Wai Minglai trembling while scrambling up the steps with all her might. She wailed miserably, Your Second Highness. He then looked at that white and plump junior manager. He had been beaten up until there was not a single piece of unscathed flesh on him. The second prince could not help but be stupefied at what he saw. This wasn't simply a failure, but that the crown prince had seen through their identities. How long had it been? He had spent such pains and effort this past half a year to cultivate this beauty. Originally planning for her to be an exquisite chess piece that he would place into the crown prince's estate, unknown to neither god nor ghost. He had even thought that this small chess piece would definitely make a stunning move in the future. However, he did not expect for all his previous efforts to get wasted today. Less than 2 hours had passed, yet the crown prince had seen through Wai Minglai and even tossed her back to the second prince's estate. The second prince felt his face hurt terribly from this face slapping, as if someone had smeared chili oil on it. It was scorchingly painful. Could it be that his, Molus, intelligence paled this much in comparison to his sixth brother's? The second prince could not accept it no matter what, and he just stood there dumbly at the entrance to the second prince's estate. He was not even aware of when the captain and his gift-bearing team had mounted their horses and left. His eyes focused straight at a single point, and his mind had gone completely blank. In addition to Wai Minglai's wails, he felt as if countless ghostly hands were pulling and howling at his brain. A show of force. This was a blatant show of force. The second prince could not get the mouthful of blood out of his chest, and his eyes rolled backward. He could not take the provocation and just fell down flat on his back with a bam in front of the main door. Oh no, oh no. The second prince has fainted from anger. Someone come quickly. Quickly go to the palace and request for a royal physician to come for emergency treatment. Your Second Highness, Your Second Highness. All hell promptly broke loose in the second prince's estate. Hash. Chapter 1424, you've got the wrong idea. On the other hand, His Highness the Crown Prince finally felt more at ease after sending his second royal brother a big gift. This wacko second prince simply grossed him out. He simply didn't understand this second royal brother's thought process. How could he be so dumb? How did he even conceive this idea to secretly train a sing-song girl to fish in troubled waters, and on top of that, toss her into his eastern palace as a spy with a method that was unknown to neither god nor ghost? Did he think that everyone was as dumb as him? What did his second royal brother take him for? Could he be so willing to bring a woman that he met through a chance encounter back to the Eastern Palace? It was still that question. What the heck was his second royal brother thinking? This second royal brother probably really was an idiot, which was why he was taking everyone else as idiots. Because of Wai Minglai's intrusion, darling Giao had already dragged Princess Xiaomi along with her back to the visitor quarters to rest by the time Molian rushed to North Main Street. After hastily running over to pick up his wifey, Crown Prince Mo ended up picking up the icicle-faced Bailey Zai instead. Zai cannot bear the honor of being welcomed personally by Your Highness the Crown Prince, Bailey Zai said expressionlessly while cupping his hands toward His Highness the Crown Prince. His Highness the Crown Prince, the Crown Prince dissed in his mind. Don't be so egocentric, we did not come to pick you up. Yet on the surface, he put on his smile that was as soothing as a spring breeze. Long time no see, the second prince of Bailey. Your bearing is still as strikingly elegant as before. Bailey's eye nodded. The Crown Prince is exaggerating. Hey, you guys. How long has it been since you two last met? Doesn't starting and ending your sentences with Your Highness the Crown Prince and the Second Prince of Bailey make you tired and annoyed? A jesting voice came from beside them. Wai Nanfeng jumped down from the rooftop like a monkey and walked up to them with a grin. I heard that you were entering the city today, so I came to welcome you. How is it? I, your brother, am really great, right? Wai Nanfeng stepped up and elbowed Bailey's eye. Let's go. It's been some time since we saw each other, so let's find a place for some drinks. By this time, the Assistant Minister of Rights, Huang Yi, had also rushed over after hearing the news. When he saw the Crown Prince, he quickly went up to make his salutations. The Crown Prince swept Assistant Minister Huang a glance and asked with seeming indifference, have you seen the Crown Prince consort?
Yes, yes,
Yes, Assistant Minister Huang nodded continuously. Mo Lian's eyes brightened when he heard this. Where is she right now? The Crown Prince Consort has just accompanied the Princess of the Southern Xiao Kingdom to the visitors' quarters.
Hey!
Wei Nanfeng flashed over and blocked Mo Lian's path with his arm.
Mo Lian, you couldn't be.
It's been less than 10 minutes since we brothers met up. Yet you're leaving now?
Crown Prince Mo immediately waved his hand.
I'll find you guys for tea another day.
Don't be kidding. What was that a chat about with these two stinking men?
Of course finding his wife was more important. After saying this, he waved his hand and abandoned those two without turning back.
He then mounted his horse, galloping toward the capital's visitors' quarters.
Bailey's eye and Wei Nanfeng were left looking at each other in dismay.
They simultaneously shook their heads and sighed in their minds.
How come Mo Lian this guy was sticking so much closer to the little stoic since these few years that they last saw him?
But speaking of which, they hadn't seen that little stoic in a long time, so they might as well.
The two people exchanged a glance and then mounted their horses, chasing after him.
After getting Princess Xiaomi settled and also chatting with her for a bit, Xiaomi finally came out from the visitors' quarters.
Before she could board her carriage, she could hear the thud of horse hooves, and a familiar voice was calling out to her from far away.
Xiao Xiao, Xiao Xiao.
Hash, chapter 1425, congratulatory gift. Xiaomi looked speechlessly at Crown Prince Mo, who was galloping over madly on his horse.
Just as he was about to reach her, that guy flew up and landed beside her with a swish.
He then cried out pitifully, "Kiao Kiao, Kiao Kiao, it's terrible.
Your hubby had almost gotten taken advantage of by a scoundrelly female hooligan.
Quickly comfort your hubby's almost injured body and mind."
"Kiao Mew, it wasn't good."
Ever since they got married, this guy's sense of shame was going downhill, and she was unable to reverse the trend no matter what.
Even so,
Xiao Mu subconsciously hugged his waist and patted his back with her petite hand.
"What female hooligan?"
Mo Lian then quickly made a clean breast of what had just happened from beginning to end to his wife.
Afterwards, he asked his wife, "Xiao Xiao, aren't I smart?
Say, is this Mo Lu dumb or what?
Where does he get the confidence that this kind of shabby move will be able to trick me?"
"Darling," Xiao was a bit furious. "Didn't the king punish this Mo Lu by taking away his monthly stipend and grounding him for 3 months? How is he able to come out now?"
"You understand the old man. Grounding and whatnot is simply impossible."
"It's already good that he doesn't wantonly change his orders."
Mo Lian pinched her petite face in amusement upon seeing her solemn expression.
"Don't worry, your hubby has always been prudent and will absolutely not get whisked away by a female hooligan."
Xiao Mu frowned.
"Where are those two people?"
"I sent people to throw them back to the second prince's estate.
It's impossible for me to keep them over for a meal.
The reports say that second royal brother was so angry that he fainted."
"Serves him right." An iciness flitted across Xiao Mu's eyes. "He got let off too lightly.
Of course I can't just let him off like this.
Since this fellow is so active, I'll find him something to do."
"Yo, as expected, you've forgotten your brothers after getting yourself a wife, Bailey.
Look, I was right on the money.
I said that this fellow was definitely coming to see the little stoic when he just ran off and cast us away."
"Okay." Bailey's eye nodded expressionlessly.
The two people hadn't seen the little lady for some time, and they couldn't resist marveling at her upon seeing her today.
She was a young icy beauty with a face like the bright moon and eyes like chilly stars.
After her facial features matured, this little stoic really made people unable to look away.
"What are you looking at?" Mo Lian pettily scooped his wifey into his arms.
"Kiao Kiao, don't pay them any attention.
We're going home."
Xiao Mu gave an ambivalent nod.
Her eyes merely ran her eyes over Wei Nanfeng and Bailey's eye before she retracted her gaze.
"You're too heartless,"
Wei Nanfeng wailed.
Ignoring him,
Xiao Mu merely looked back at Bailey's eye and said with a nod, "Thank you for the ebony tablets you sent over."
"It was nothing." Bailey's eye nodded with a tepid expression.
"This is for you." The little stoic waved her hand casually, and a brocade pouch landed in Bailey's eye's hands.
"I see that you are about to break through to become a level 13 mystic cultivator.
There are 2 level 13 mystic breakthrough pills inside the porcelain bottle.
They can probably help you break through successfully."
Although the little stoic was not making much of an expression,
Her words triggered a thousand waves. Bailey's I and Wine and Fing were both flabbergasted, especially our dear Wine and Fing, who was posing as the peanut gallery. He had originally been fanning him tastefully with his folding fan. Yet he got so freaked out by Kiao Mu's words that he dropped his fan, and he was thunderstruck, with a gust of wind blowing over his head. Princess Mi said that you two are about to get married, so consider this as my early wedding gift to you. Chapter 1426, Mutual Compliment. You're getting married? Wine and Fing and Mo Lian both turned to look at the bewildered Bailey's Eye. Bailey's Eye had yet to recover from his ecstatic joy of receiving two level 13 mystic breakthrough pills when he was plunged into the stupefaction of getting married. How come he did not know when he was going to get married? By now, the little stoic had pattered up to him and reached up to pat Bailey's Eye's shoulder. Xiaomi is quite good. You're an icicle face who doesn't like talking, while Xiaomi is chatty all day, so you won't get depressed in the future. You two just so happen to compliment each other. Treat her well. The three men present, PFFD Wine and Fing, let out an untimely laugh. The little stoic promptly swept him a disdainful glance. What do you, someone without a wife, know? Yet you still have the cheek to laugh at other people. Just stay a bachelor your whole life, Wine and Fing. Ha 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 ha. Mo Lian really couldn't hold it in and laughed out loud. He flashed up to her and took his wifey into his arms. Kiao Kiao, Kiao Kiao, my Kiao Kiao. Wine and Fing couldn't help but be exasperated. Hey, brother, can you say something to your wife? How come she still doesn't like me after so many years have passed since then? Look, look, when it came to Bailey's Eye, she gave him two precious level 13 mystic breakthrough pills, while for him, there was no harm without comparison. But once there was comparison, it could simply infuriate one to death. Not only did he not get a mystic breakthrough pill, he even got dissed by the little stoic. You think you're all that just because you got married? Alright, you guys should rest early too. Tomorrow, I'll have people take you around the city, while grandmother will summon you the day after that. After Crown Prince Mo finished saying this, he held his wifey's hand and galloped away on his horse while carrying her. Wine and Fing could not help but be jealous of the two who were glued together and deeply attached to each other. He mumbled, if I had known, I would have also married a devoted wife early, and then the stoic face wouldn't be stabbing me in the heart today. Bailey's Eye put away the brocade pouch with the two level 13 mystic breakthrough pills and directly strode into the visitors' quarters. When Wine and Fing saw this, he couldn't help but shout in a huff, hey, Bailey's Eye, you don't know to console your brother. You really weren't a considerate fellow. One day later, the Queen Dowager's magnificent birthday feast commenced inside the Longevity Palace's brocade garden. Court officials third rank and above had long arrived in the main hall of the Longevity Palace's brocade garden with their dressed-up family members. The manager eunuch was announcing, His Third Highness of Northern Wai congratulates the Queen Dowager on her major birthday and presents a pair of bright pearls from the Hope Sea, a measure of white jade pearls. His Second Highness of Southern Bailey congratulates and sincerely wishes the Queen Dowager a long life. One group of foreign guests after another walked into the main hall with smiling and rosy faces. The Queen Dowager was sitting in the main seat at the top of the steps. She was dressed in crimson and smiled at the people who had come from all over to congratulate her. Nanny Gu was standing next to the Queen Dowager, and she would occasionally bend her waist to explain to the Queen Dowager from which country the guest standing in the main hall at that moment hailed from. As today was the joyous occasion of her 70th birthday, the Queen Dowager was in great spirits as she looked at the generations of offspring filling the house, unable to restrain her smile. The young chief of the Akdo tribe wishes the Queen Dowager a happy birthday and presents. The young princess of the Alava tribe congratulates the Queen Dowager on her birthday and presents. The guests' gift lists were announced in succession, one after another. Everyone gazed upon this prosperous scene with smiling faces. Meanwhile, Kiao Mu was sitting next to the Crown Prince indifferently, but she raised her eyes when she heard the eunuch announce the Alava tribe's name. Chapter 1427, Meeting. The Alava tribe gave her a sense of familiarity. Kiao Mu had only found the name of this tribe familiar when she saw a red figure leading a dozen people with a distinctive tribal air into the main hall. This red-clothed young lady was around 18 years old, and she was dressed sharply in a crimson riding outfit paired with black riding boots. Her hair was tied up, showing a petite face that was fair like the moon. There was a tiny but extremely familiar dimple in her left cheek. Qiaomu's eyes bulged, and she shot up from her seat almost uncontrollably. The crown prince was startled and looked up at his wifey, who had suddenly stood up. While at this time, the red-clothed young lady had seemingly also noticed this person who had abruptly stood up. Upon registering that stoic face of Qiaomu's, her eyes instantly turned round. However, before she could stride up to meet up with Qiaomu, a burly man with stubble suddenly stepped out from the Akdo tribe and laughed boorishly with a contemptuous expression. "Haha, the little rats from the Alava tribe actually have the courage to come out from their tiny caves and travel into the borders of northern Mo. How have you been hiding during this journey?" The people from the Akdo tribe broke into uproarious laughter. They completely did not care if they were attracting the attention of other guests as they belittled the red-clothed young lady from the Alava tribe on the spot. The red-clothed young lady untied her treasured sword from her waist and struck it toward the burly man's chest. She then shoved him backward with it and stated frostily, "Today is the major birthday of Northern Mo's royal queen dowager, so this young lady will not be stooping to your level." Scram! The burly man with stubble from the Akdo tribe immediately jumped up and hurled his fist furiously at the red-clothed young lady. His action incurred the dissatisfaction of many Northern Mo officials. Each of them was looking coldly at him with suppressed anger, but because he was a guest and the king and queen dowager had yet to say anything, they naturally could not be the first to step out and make unwarranted charges. Swoosh, swoosh, swoosh. Crack. A wily green vine shot out from who knows where and whipped fiercely at the burly man's big fist. Ow! A bloody welt appeared on the burly man's fist from this strike, and he roared uncontrollably. Among everyone present, the invited sects and patriarchs from the patrician families all couldn't resist twitching their mouths. It was coming, it was coming, it was coming again. This unlucky man just had to behave so rampantly in front of the young crown prince consort. You got served. Although most of the people did not know who had made the move, they all secretly felt pleased. This person from the Akdo tribe actually acted in spite of appearances and attacked another one of the Northern Mo's guests during the Queen Dowager's birthday feast. They indeed needed to be taught ceremony and protocol. Who attacked me? Who? That burly man with the stubble turned around furiously as he scanned back and forth through the main hall. Everyone glowered at him with stern expressions. Even the Queen Dowager, who was constantly smiling, had also turned austere at this time as her furious gaze settled on the burly man. The king smacked the table and hollered furiously, "Who are you? How can you be so discourteous?" The burly man with the stubble was still respectful and fearful of the king of Northern Mo. He quickly put his hand horizontally across his chest when he heard this and saluted deferentially to the king. "Honorable king of Northern Mo, this humble one is a Chilyak of the Akdo tribe, Kaysen. This humble one has come with our young chief to congratulate Her Majesty the Queen Dowager of Northern Mo and present gifts for her birthday." Chapter 1428. Let me give you an explanation. Yet this humble one actually got attacked for no reason. As the king of Northern Mo, should you not give this humble one an explanation? After all, your great Mo kingdom has the responsibility to protect this humble one, your guest. Everyone could not help but be livid at Kaysen's scoundrelly behavior. The hell with an explanation. You were the one who attacked someone else first during the Queen Dowager's birthday feast. Yet you think you are in the right? You actually have the cheek to complain to the king and demand an explanation now after getting whipped by someone in secret? The people from the Akdo tribe stood to the side and did not say anything, looking on with interest at this development instead. The Akdo tribe had always been the strongest tribe in the Western Wastelands. Their people never needed tears nor to beg for mercy. If they were met with any trouble, they would face it head on themselves. Kaysen was their Akdo tribe's Chilyak, a strong and intrepid level 13 body cultivator. They believed that Kaysen would not be at a disadvantage with his strength. However, they seemed to be a bit overconfident. "Let me give you an explanation." An icy voice traveled over from the front of the main hall. They suddenly saw a red figure flashing in front of Kaysen. Her snow-white features did not form any expression, only emitting a chilly and austere air. Kaysen was startled, and then a lascivious look surfaced in his eyes, but before he could make a pass at her, a tremendous force suddenly hit his body. Kaysen was gobsmacked, completely not expecting this little lady to be so quick to act. Before he could say anything, his entire being had been swept up by a tremendous force, and he stumbled out of the main hall. Kaysen simply did not know what had happened. But everyone else inside the main hall saw everything that had happened clearly and distinctly. Without room for objection, the young crown prince consort had struck her palm from a distance, and the dense mystic energy pushed Kaysen flying out. She had sent a level 13 body cultivator flying with this single move. The strength behind this strike probably weighed 1,000 pounds. The expressionless young crown prince consort shot forward like an arrow, and she had already leapt out of the main hall. Before the unlucky Kaysen could get up from the ground, a palm formed from the earth spirit covered Kaysen's body firmly. At the same time, everyone inside the main hall swarmed outside to spectate. They watched Kaysen get slapped into the flower bed nearby by an earth spirit palm. He formed a human-shaped pit and spat out a mouthful of blood as fertilizer for the flower bed. Cough, cough, cough. Kaysen gazed in shock at the little lady. He would never have expected that he, a level 13 body cultivator, would be unable to take a single attack from the little lady. What was the situation? Even if this little lass had started absorbing the mystic energy of heaven and earth from her mother's womb, she wouldn't have grown to this extent. An awe-inspiring ice sword appeared in Kiao Mu's hand, and she gazed apathetically at him, saying, "Because it is grandmother's major birthday today, I will spare your life. For now, do not provoke me. You will be unable to handle the consequences." The little stoic turned toward the red-clothed young lady after calmly giving this warning. Yet who knew that the young lady would shout, "Little junior sister, watch out." "Kaysen, stop right there." Asi roared. Kaysen flitted to her from behind. A sinister and vicious light emitted from his eyes as he bashed his fists toward the back of the young crown prince consort's head. Hash. Chapter 1429, Gone Easy. "You're seeking death." A cold light flashed through Crown Prince Mo's eyes, and he moved to fly next to the little stoic. Yet the little stoic's figure abruptly disappeared from the spot. Kaysen's fists missed their mark, and he stumbled forward while stupefied. The young chief of the Akdo tribe, Usi, had already reached him by this time, and he slapped Kaysen heavily across the face without allowing for an explanation. "I told you to stop. Did you not hear? Who gave you the gall to injure her fatally?" Kaysen shrunk his neck servilely as he pressed his hand against his swollen left cheek. When he turned around, he saw the young crown prince consort jumping down from the roof of the main hall. Everyone stared at her, dumbstruck. They looked at where she had disappeared from and then at the roof of the main hall. Fook, that was such a great distance away. They could not figure out how she would be jumping down from the rooftop. However, Mo Lian moved next to her with a flash and grasped her petite hand. He knew that this little fellow had gone easy on the man on account of grandmother. The majority of people did not know what had happened, but the people with discerning eyes were cognizant of the fact that the young crown prince consort had used a talisman. Qiao Mu had indeed used a teleportation talisman to teleport away because she was worried that if this went on, she would be unable to control herself from butchering this stinking man on the spot. A weakling dared to launch a sneak attack from behind on her. There were gaps in his defense everywhere. It had to be known that Qiao Mu had a dozen ways for him to die embarrassingly on the spot in that split second. However, should someone die during grandmother's lively birthday feast, even she herself would feel grossed out, not to mention that grandmother might have other thoughts. Kaysen was unaware that the Queen Daiju had saved his life. He did not understand what kind of witchcraft the young crown prince consort had used to rapidly move herself to the rooftop. When he looked at the young crown prince consort, his whole body shuddered, and he retracted his gaze. He felt that this gaze of the little lady's was a bit too piercing and could not be looked at directly. Is it that young Chief Asi does not know how to manage his subordinates? "This crown prince does not mind helping you out." Mo Lian swept us a glance and walked back to the main hall while holding Qiao Mu's hand before he could reply. Qiao Mu had too many questions to ask the red-clothed young lady from the Alava tribe, but grandmother's birthday congratulations came first. Everything else could wait for now. However, her large eyes would frequently wander to the red-clothed young lady from the Alava tribe, and everyone could tell that her eyes were shining so brightly that they could not be suppressed. Situ Yi nodded at the red-clothed young lady, and he fanned himself while chatting with the people near his seat. I really did not expect to see Junior Sister Doya to be safe and sound after what happened all those years ago. Liang Qingqing couldn't resist exclaiming from the next table over. They had been very familiar with those young ladies from the Holy Water sect back when they were traveling to the competition at Xixia Valley. It's not surprising for little junior sister to be so happy. Situ Yi paused his fanning and then said this with a faint smile. The Queen Dowager smiled at her granddaughter-in-law from where she was sitting in the main seat. She had regained her joyous expression and nodded with a smile at the guests that were continuing to enter the main hall. The third Crown Prince of Eastern Ying Kingdom congratulates the Queen Dowager on her major birthday. His gift is a pair of blue spiritual sparrows, a fish dragon mystic jade, 5 fluorescent spiritual tablets. Commandery Princess Yin has arrived. Accompanied by this announcement, Yin, dressed in a resplendent gown, walked slowly into the main hall with fluttering sleeves. She momentarily attracted all the guests' gazes. No wonder she is the commandery princess who has always been accompanying Her Majesty the Queen Dowager. Beautiful and tasteful, dainty but admirable. Chapter 1430, Impressive Birthday Present. Although the hushed voices of praise around her were not loud, Yin enjoyed it immensely. They were praising her with all their might. Sure enough, she was exceptional. As she had said, she completely did not pale in comparison to that Crown Prince consort. It was just unfortunate that His Highness the Crown Prince maintained his distance from beginning to end and was unwilling to look at her squarely. Otherwise, she would definitely let him know her merits. Commandery Princess Yin maintained an appropriate smile and walked up gracefully to the bottom of the steps. After standing still, she docilely saluted the Queen Dowager and spoke softly. Your Majesty the Queen Dowager wishes Your Majesty the Queen Dowager good fortune and a long life. Yin has specially prepared a little something for the Queen Dowager to show my filial devotion. Behind her, Xua, who was lowering her head in curtsy, hastily raised a red tray above her head. An exquisite crimson 100 longevity scroll rested upon it and was shown overtly to everyone present. Ho! The Commandery Princess personally embroidered a 100 longevity scroll for Her Majesty the Queen Dowager. As expected, her filial devotion is commendable. Look at this 100 longevity scroll that is several meters long. The embroidery work is of the best quality. It is evident at a glance that she put in much time and effort. Yes. Yes. Eh? It looks like it is not only this 100 longevity scroll. There is also a porcelain bottle. Yin could not help but reveal a proud expression when she heard everyone mentioning the porcelain bottle on the tray. There is a high rank prolongation pill inside the porcelain bottle. Yin hopes that it will be useful to Your Majesty the Queen Dowager. Wow, sounds of discussion filled the main hall. Could it be that it was Commandery Princess Yin who had successfully bid on the prolongation pill for an astronomical price at the House of Treasures last time? Yo, I had heard about the two. Everyone praised Commandery Princess Yin while smiling. Her filial devotions could move the heavens. In order to extend Her Majesty the Queen Dowager's lifespan, she did not hesitate to purchase a prolongation pill at an astronomical price. Consuming a prolongation pill actually did not make much of a difference to Her Majesty the Queen Dowager, as she was already at the phenomenal success rank of level 14 mystic cultivation. Although the prolongation pill was a high rank pill, its effects were less pronounced for cultivators with a higher cultivation. Besides, it was said that this prolongation pill that the House of Treasures had auctioned was merely a mid-grade pill. The medicinal effects diverged widely depending on the pill's grade. If Her Majesty the Queen Dowager were to take this prolongation pill, her lifespan would extend for at least one or two more years. However, this was considered time that she got for free. As a cultivator, who did not wish to have a longer lifespan so as to have more time to break through to the next level? Everyone's gazes turned fervent upon hearing that it was a prolongation pill. Some of the invited patriarchs from the patrician families, especially, had fixed their bright gazes on the porcelain bottle. The junior manager eunuch took the tray and walked up the steps before respectfully presenting the 100 longevity scroll and the porcelain bottle to the Queen Dowager. The Queen Dowager's eyes flickered, And she looked at Commandery Princess Yin indifferently before smiling with a nod. You've taken a lot of trouble. These words were polite and distant, and it made Yin a bit uncomfortable. She then thought it over. Once the Queen Dowager consumed this prolongation pill and benefited from it, the Queen Dowager naturally would treat her as well as she did in the past. This distant manner was only temporary. Everyone seems to be a bit curious about the prolongation pill. Since this is so, then pass it around for everyone's perusal. Yes, Queen Dowager. The junior manager eunuch quickly walked down the steps again while holding the red tray. Everyone was overjoyed, and they passed around the porcelain bottle to examine the pill inside. The little stoic was startled. Meanwhile, someone smiled while turning to look at the pill. Patrician family's patriarch and its two young sirs. Hash.